When you create a new data source in the Tinybird UI, Tinybird will automatically infer the schema from the data you provide, create the data source, and append the data. It's a three-step process collapsed into a single action. But sometimes you want to be able to edit the data source schema before you start appending data to it. Editing the schema can reduce the disk space your data source occupies, and it can have some performance improvements down the line. And once you add data to the data source, you can't change the schema. In this screencast, I'll show you how to modify a data source schema in the Tinybird CLI and how those schema changes can impact performance later on. Let's get after it. Okay, so I've authenticated to the Tinybird CLI with my workspace user admin token, and we're just going to create a data source from this ndjson file that we have containing 100,000 rows of e-commerce web events data. It's even got some nested JSON objects in here and this little extra data object. Now, to create the data source, we're going to type tb data source generate and then paste that ndjson file path. Now we'll push it to the server with tb push and the data source file path, and then append the data to it with tb data source append, the data source name, and that same ndjson file path. And just to see that the data source does have data in it, you can just do a quick tb sql select count from events 100k, and you get 100,000 as expected. So that's essentially how you would use the CLI to run that three-step process that happens automatically when you create a data source in the UI. Let's open up that data source file to take a look at the schema. You can see that Tinybird has flattened those nested JSON objects into separate columns using the extra data prefix from that JSON key. And you'll notice that two of these columns are nullable because some of the rows were missing one or more key value pairs in that nested object. Now, before we change anything, let's create a very simple API endpoint on this data source to get the number of buy events from the city of Nashville, which is where I happen to live. So we'll do tb pipe generate Nashville buy events, select count from events 100k, where extra data city equals Nashville and event equals buy. Then we'll push that to the server with tb push, and now get the data from it with tb pipe data Nashville buy events. So you can see that there were 433 buy events in Nashville in this relatively small data set. Now, one thing to pay attention to here is that this query read all 100,000 rows in the data source for about 3.5 megabytes of processed data. Now, let's do what we came here to do and edit the schema. We'll make a copy of this data source file and call it refactor-events100k.datasource. Now let's open that bad boy up. Okay, let's start with the obvious stuff, like the event column. This is a string, but there are only ever going to be a very small number of event types. So we can change this to a low cardinality string type to save some space. And the user ID, for example, is an int32, but we won't ever have negative IDs, so we can make this a uint32. And let's just go ahead and change the names of those nested objects and then drop the extra data prefix for clarity. Finally, you'll notice that this data source file doesn't explicitly define a sorting key. In fact, if we were to look at the data source schema in the Tinybird UI, we'd see that the primary sorting key was set to the date column, which kind of happens by default. Now, this might make sense for certain queries, but since we're building APIs that filter on city and event, it makes more sense for us to use those as our sorting keys. So let's explicitly define those sorting keys in the schema, and you can go ahead and keep the date column as a tertiary key in case you want to get fancy later on. Now, we'll push this refactor data source to the server with tb push, and then go ahead and append the same data to it. So we have the same columns, same number of rows, different schema. First, notice the change in disk space for this refactor data source. The table with the default schema was just shy of 3 megabytes, and this refactored version is 2.3 megabytes, which is nearly a 25% reduction in size. Now, 3 megabytes is nothing, I get it, but as this data source grows to billions of rows, you'll be grateful for that 25% reduction. Now, let's edit that endpoint we created earlier to run on the refactored data source. So, open it up in VS Code, edit the query by changing the data source and the city column name in the filter, save it, then head back to the terminal and push it to the server with the force flag. Now, when we use the force flag, the CLI shows us some performance metrics between old and new, And you can see that by explicitly defining the sorting keys, the amount of data scanned dropped to less than a megabyte. That's more than a 3.5x reduction. So while a few megabytes isn't a lot, as this table grows, those performance gains will significantly reduce both query time and cost. So schema matters. If you're just getting started with Tinybird and you're still prototyping, you don't need to worry about it too much. But if you're serious about speed, taking the time to edit the schema before you add data to the data source, especially before you ship to production, can have a serious effect on performance and cost. See you next time.